So we were bouncing around and having a good time until 3 o'clock in the morning. And I strangled him. And I put him in the middle of the bed. I put his arms across his chest. Kissed him on the lips and said, you know, you're in a better place now.
Every single one of us has a big story. Events that make us who we are, shape us, inform what we do with our lives, who we become. These big stories are simply extraordinary, defining moments that make or break people. From them, we can learn, empathize, and connect. These are the turning points that change people's lives. These stories must be told, starting right now. David Carmichael and his wife Beth love their family life in Toronto, Canada, with eldest daughter Gillian and young son Ian.
Our family was a middle-class family and we all got along well. Gillian was the older sister of Ian and they got along very well. Ian was a great, fun-loving boy. He was a BMXer. He loved his little BMX. He BMXed with our daughter Gillian and he got so interested that we actually built a half pipe in our backyard in Toronto. And they just played on it and we went to skate parks and, you know, he was just a fun-loving, beautiful boy. And my wife and I worked hard to make sure they had a nice environment to grow up in. We had a family cottage we went to. It was wonderful. I loved parenting.
Ian had very mild epilepsy and was a December baby, which meant he was young for his class and a late developer, but was an otherwise happy, healthy boy.
He was makes him younger than most of the children, so he might have been a little bit behind. But he enjoyed learning, just like most children do.
In 2003, David had a senior role working for a national fitness organization called Participaction.
Those are some of the basic skills that parents can do with their children when they're young.
It was a job he loved, promoting fitness to ordinary Canadians. But in 2003, Health Canada cut funding to the program. David was gutted. His company needed $5 million to stay afloat, but the government refused.
Well, the overall budget of Health Canada for healthcare was $200 billion at the time, and they couldn't find $5 million. So I became quite distressed. When I lost that job, you know, what came next was a recession. I started leveraging all the assets that we had, our, you know, RSPs, credit lines, you know, we tried to do all of that. And unfortunately, you get to a point where you just have nothing more to leverage.
David was distressed and anxious. He went to his doctor, who diagnosed major depression and said he should take an antidepressant called Paroxetine, sold then under the trade name of Paxil.
My doctor prescribed Paxil in Canada or Airpax in Australia. And I started to have some side effects like akathisia is what they call it. It's an agitation, irritation, but that didn't last long. I wasn't working very much, so I was able to recover slowly over time, and I was on it for about 8 months. And had a couple of side effects that I didn't like particularly. One was sexual dysfunction, which affects a lot of people. And then I had also put on weight. And I'd missed taking my medication for a few days, and I started to feel fine. So I said, you know, I'm going to take a look and research how I can get off the medication, because I mean, pharmaceutical companies provide a lot of information on how to get people onto prescription drugs. Very little information out there on how to come off. So I did my own research and weaned myself off over about 5 weeks. And I actually was feeling pretty good.
David took himself off the antidepressant and managed to find work directing kids' summer camp. In July 2004, the workload became overwhelming. He soon slipped back into a familiar depression.
So I lost weight quickly, and I realized there was something wrong. So I put myself on I had a full prescription of Paxil from February, and it had not expired. So instead of going back to my doctor, I put myself back on the same dosage that I was on when I was on it for the first time.
David says his doctor had never warned him of potential dangers of the drug, so he thought he was doing the right thing.
So he prescribed the drug, and he told me I had a chemical imbalance in my brain. You know, if you're told you have a chemical imbalance, and this particular drug, which is called a selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor, SSRI, antidepressant, can correct it, then you just, you know, your doctor's got to be right. So I just blindly trusted my doctor and started taking the drug. You know, I was told one side effect when I was prescribed Paxil. Not one.
Without consulting a doctor, David put himself back on his antidepressant and back to his original dose. For those viewing, this goes against all medical advice. We'll hear from a medical expert soon. David says once he was back on the drug, he very quickly suffered severe adverse reactions.
Right away, I started to have akathisia, which is an agitation, irritation. And I started to have suicidal thoughts for the first time starting a drug. And I thought there was something wrong. And after, within the first week when I was having suicidal thoughts, I thought, I need to do something here. So by the weekend, I thought, if I increase my dosage, like taking 2 aspirin instead of 1, I could get better more quickly and get back to doing my job properly at the summer camp. So I increased to the maximum dosage of Aripex or Paxil, and that didn't help. I became suicidal. I started planning my suicides, and as soon as I increased my dosage, almost immediately, I became delusional.
1 week later, David was suffering severe psychosis. He started to think the unthinkable. He truly believed that his 11-year-old son, Ian, was dangerous and needed to die.
And the way that a forensic psychiatrist explained psychosis to me is you take an issue and you sort of blow it out of proportion 30 times. So it becomes what they call a fixed false belief. You actually believe that Ian's got permanent brain damage. That time I thought he was going to kill his sister, even though they had a great relationship. None of this makes sense to me at all, any more than it does to your viewers. It just doesn't make any sense to me sitting here today. And I thought my wife was going to have a nervous breakdown. It was going to hurt other children. And I decided that I was going to take him away to this hotel. We're going to have a wonderful evening. And that I was going to take his life. So we went to the hotel. And this was on a Friday night, July 30th, 2004. And we had a wonderful dinner. We had room service, his favorite foods. And I looked at it as his last meal. We watched his favorite movie, and I gave him the sleeping medication around 8 o'clock at night, and he started to hallucinate. He wasn't going to sleep. So we were bouncing around and having a good time until 3 o'clock in the morning, and I strangled him. And I put him in the middle of the bed. I put his arms across his chest, kissed him on the lips, and said, you're in a better place now, and I love you. And sat down and I watched TV very calmly for 6 hours. And then I called 911 at 9 o'clock in the morning, and I waited till 9 o'clock in the morning because I didn't want to disturb the other guests in the hotel. And I calmly called 911 and I told them what I had done.
Hi there.
Hi.
Okay. You've killed somebody, sir?
Yes, my 11-year-old son who's got some permanent brain damage. And
okay, how did you kill him?
I drugged him and gave him some sleep easy stuff. And then...
How long ago did you do this?
3 o'clock in the morning. He probably died.
Okay, is your son breathing at all?
No. No, he's quite dead.
Okay.
And I was arrested and charged with first-degree murder, and I was prepared to spend 25 years in prison thinking that I did the right thing for just not Ian, but for my entire family. And it is unbelievable to me that I could have ever been in that state of mind. After I was arrested, I went to jail and was calmly through the system, and I was still psychotic for 2 weeks. So the psychosis didn't stop right away. It stopped the drug right away. It took me right off the drug. And I was in a segregation on my own and on suicide watch. And it took about 2 weeks for me to start to come out of my psychosis. And I cried for 3 days straight. And I could not believe what I had done. I not only had taken Ian's life, I destroyed my family. I mean, what do you do after that? My wife had to deal with all this, my daughter. At that point in time, I was as shocked as anybody else was. Well, the first time Beth and I met one-on-one, I just looked at her. I mean, what do you say? Our life is ruined, and you know, our son is gone, and how do you rebuild from there? And we both were just in tears. We really didn't say very much at all. You know, I was just so confused about how anything like that could have happened, and so was she. It was almost a suspicious interaction, you know, with her on one side of the glass and me on the other.
In his murder trial, David was diagnosed as being in a psychotic depression at the time he killed his son. He was found not criminally responsible and was sent to a mental health centre. After 4 years, the doctors believed he was no longer a danger to himself or others and granted his release.
When I received my absolute discharge, I tried to find work and it was very difficult. I mean, when you really think about it, there's really not much more heinous than taking the life of your own child. So I had a stigma that was off the chart. I mean, people have stigmas for mental illness. Mine was really off the chart. So I dealt with a tremendous amount of abandonment and rejection, but my purpose kept me going. And my family stuck with me, you know, my wife Beth, my daughter Gillian.
It was during his time in the mental health facility that David began researching adverse side effects from prescription medication. He discovered his purpose in life, to share his horrific family tragedy as a cautionary tale.
I wanted to speak out because to me, part of my healing, a major part of my healing, was finding a purpose in all this. And I'm not against prescription drugs, but I'm about informed consent and I'm about being able to make choices, you know, informed choices about the drug, which often you don't get all the information from your doctor, so people have to do more research on their own. And that's really what I was doing. I was trying to help others to prevent tragedies like ours.
Years after he was released, David sued the maker of Paxil, GlaxoSmithKline. Ultimately, David would lose his case in Canada's Supreme Court because of the statute of limitations. He left it too late. 7news.com.au reached out to GSK about David's story. They sent us this statement.
With respect to the legal case involving David Carmichael, this case was dismissed by the Ontario Court of Appeal in 2020. The tragic circumstances of this case serve as an important reminder that depression and other mental illnesses are serious disorders.
David's purpose in life is to educate others, to ask questions. He's about to embark on a national tour in Canada and hopes to travel the world again soon, spreading his message about research.
My role is to share the story and to facilitate discussions and to get people to just start to think a little bit more. You know, I would call it creating some healthy skepticism about the pharmaceutical system and our healthcare system. The most difficult thing for me was forgiving myself. And part of that was reaching out and helping other families that have either been harmed or close to harm. And I've dealt with a lot of people that have attempted suicide but not committed suicide, and they've adopted healthy lifestyles, a lot of the people that I talk with. And that has helped me. You know, when you go through a tragedy like ours, it's very hard to forgive yourself. Regardless of whether it was a drug or whether it wasn't, the reality is, I struggled with my son, and my son is gone. I'll never recover from that.
David's pain is real. He has to live every day with the fact he took his own son's life. But his mission to help others is what gets him through. We wanted to know, despite everything that happened, would Ian be proud of the work his dad is doing?
Well, that's a question I've never been asked. I hope Ian would be proud of what I'm doing today. You know, he was the ultimate sacrifice in all this. So, I certainly hope so. You know, my tours for Ian, almost everything I do is for Ian. And I think about him several times every day. You know, 17 years later, I know I'll never recover from this. But what keeps me going is my purpose. I feel that if I can help other people and other families not go through what our family went through, then that really does give me the reason to speak out and to try to educate others.
Professor Philip Morris is the president of Australia's National Association of Practicing Psychiatrists. He says that while David's case is exceptionally rare, anyone who has a reaction to any medication needs to report it.
It's likely that reactions are going to be underreported because it requires the patient to either contact their doctor or occasionally their pharmacist or to report it in a written form, and that takes a bit of effort. Yeah, look, I don't think people do read the fine print. They do rely on their doctors to interpret the information for them, and so doctors usually will tell patients the common side effects. The idea of just going off the medication yourself is very, very bad policy. You must go back and discuss that with your doctor.